Officers here, they're talking about a truce with the Germans.
That'll make no difference. According to these dispatches, the whole Eastern Front's collapsed anyway. The Tsar's gone. The troops are packing in and drifting back home.
No, not yet.
They've got no supplies, no food.
Thank you.
Complete shambles.
Well, it's pretty obvious, isn't it? Ludendorff will bring back all the divisions he's got over there and mass them all on the Western Front. We're barely holding out there as it is. Once he does that, well, it's all over.
The devil is LG. Has anybody seen him?
No. Not for 6 hours. Strict orders not to be disturbed.
God, that sounds bad.
Why?
Well, I mean, what the hell can he be doing all that time?
Getting ready to surrender.
Never.
In the end, somebody's got to lose. You may decide if the odds are too great, it would just be throwing lives away to carry on.
Or perhaps he's drafting a statement to prepare public opinion.
Oh, I just can't believe it.
It'll be the hardest thing he's ever had to write.
Oh. What's all this conclave in aid of then? Hasn't anyone got any work to do?
We were all talking about Russia, Prime Minister.
Thought it might be. Well, the first thing we've got to do then is to make it clear to this nation that it's the best news we've had in months.
Prime Minister, the Eastern Front has collapsed.
Well, that hardly comes under the heading of news. Somebody get me a coffee, please. It collapsed weeks ago. There's been a de facto ceasefire there for over a month. Now they're calling it a truce. The Germans can't leave that front undefended for anything less than a peace treaty. And Kerensky is certainly not going to give them that.
Well, nothing is certain. Anything could happen.
Oh. Well, one thing is certain. The Tsar won't be climbing back onto that throne again. And look at the weapon that puts in our hands. Sit down a moment. Well, sit down. Look at America, President Wilson. It's 18 months now since the Lusitania was sunk. He can see more American ships being blown to smithereens every month, and yet he still stands there and turns the other cheek. Why? Because from over there, this war's looked like nothing on earth but a bunch of corrupt European dynasties up to their knees in blood slaughtering each other. The Habsburgs on one side, the Romanovs on the other. Why should America get mixed up in anything so squalid? But now, it's a war for democracy. It's a people's war. It's a war for progress, for a new and better world. And if that doesn't draw the Americans in, then I'm a Dutchman. Telegram to the new Russian government.
Yes.
It is with sentiments of profound satisfaction. What are you sitting about for? It is with sentiments. Thank you. What did I say?
Sentiments of profound satisfaction.
All right. That the people of Great Britain have learned that their great ally, Russia, now stands with the nations which base their institutions upon responsible government. This revolution by the Russian people reveals the fundamental truth that this war is a struggle for popular government as well as national liberty. How is the invalid today?
A bit better. Oh, tell me all the news. No, only the good news.
Well, the best news to come out of 10 Downing Street is a medical bulletin on Miss Megan Lloyd-George, who did not contract meningitis and is rapidly recovering from the effects of measles.
But looking very scruffy and spotty.
Looking as enchanting as ever.
Oh, Tada, what if you caught it? We'd probably lose the war or something.
I had it when I was 5. Drink this.
What is it?
Honey, cream, port wine, and raw egg.
What's the second best news?
Well, the second best news is that America has officially declared war on Germany. The Irish are holding a convention on home rule. We should keep things quiet for a while. And your mother is out buying a hat for Dick's wedding.
Nobody sounds very keen on Dick's wedding. Why is that?
I suppose we hoped he'd marry Dillis. And not this McAlpine girl.
This McAlpine girl will have pots of money, though, won't she?
She'll have to keep it well away from Dick, too, if she wants it to last more than 6 months. And I suppose Dillis would have gone down better in Wales.
Bona Law on the telephone. It's nothing urgent, but he says he'd like a word.
Right.
I'm sure you're right about Dillis, Tadda. And I expect Wales could do with some reassuring news about this family.
Look, drink that up now. Francis made it for you. It's her own recipe. And it will do you good. I'll see you soon. See you later.
Are you feeling better?
Not much.
How are you getting on in school?
Adequately.
We don't seem to have been seeing so much of one another lately, do we?
No, Miss Stevenson. I finally came to realize why you used to drop all those little hints in the course of conversation about the virtue of being broad-minded. You must have thought I was very stupid.
No. I began to think you probably guessed. And perhaps even understood.
I realize my mother is a lot older than you, and a bit old-fashioned, and provincial, and so on. I don't want you to imagine I'm not aware of all that, because I am. But that doesn't mean that I don't object to outsiders butting in and messing up our family life. And it's certainly no excuse for someone like you trying to make a fool of my father.
That's enough.
You may think that if you hang on long enough, my mother'll be dead, and you'll have him all to yourself. But you're forgetting one thing, Miss Stevenson. I am not older than you. I'll still be you, and you're gone.
They've been lying to me. Come here! I want all communications from GHQ for the last 3 days. Oh, there you are.
The shipping controller is on his way. It'll take him half an hour.
Yes.
The adjutant general isn't in his office.
God in heaven.
But his staff will have the figures available by the time the rest of the cabinet arrive.
It is 3 weeks since Lenin and Trotsky made peace with the Germans. A child would realize that Ludendorff was going to bring his troops back from the east and launch an offensive. Where's Hanke?
Not here, Prime
Minister. Well, I can see he's not here. I want him here. Fetch him! It's obvious what the Germans are trying to do. They're trying to drive a wedge here between the British Army and the French Army. Precisely why I wanted to set up an inter-allied general reserve. A mobile force behind the lines. But no, no. Haig sabotaged that one, didn't he? Unilaterally. Dug his heels in. Wouldn't cooperate. And now we are sunk. No cause for anxiety. Blackest day of the war. It's total disaster. The Germans
have broken through the reserve lines, through the battle zone. We've lost 40,000 troops, 600 guns, and what is the message that keeps coming through to me? No cause for anxiety. Ah, there you are. Cancel the cabinet meeting.
Cancel it?
Cancel it. We're going straight to the War Office. Oh, wait. What's on the agenda?
The industrial unrest, Prime Minister. The AEU and the shop stewards movement calling for pacifism. Ireland to discuss the breakdown of the National Convention. The Sinn Féiners are... Russia, you wanted to consider re-establishing relations with the Bolshevik government.
Ah, Lenin has torpedoed that one, hasn't he? Cancel all that and arrange for an emergency meeting immediately of the War Cabinet for this afternoon. One item, the German war offensive. And in the meantime, where are the Americans? It's 9 months since President Wilson entered this war. Where are they? In America. Coach, you, Hank, you come with me. I'm going straight to the War Office.
It's no
good. Yes?
It's no good going in that room.
We will leave in 5 minutes. Sir Robert Hutchinson, ascertain number of troops immediately available. Sir Joseph McClay, commandeer shipping for troop transport 20,000 a day. Commons, activate emergency clause for extending age limits of conscripts available for drafting. President Wilson, telegram. General Foch. General Foch, myself or Lord Milner to leave for Paris to arrange to bring both armies under united control.
I've got something for you.
What?
Bedtime reading. Cowboys.
Pussy. You will try and behave yourself in another way, won't you?
People in glass houses.
From Brittany, are you? Vous parlez la langue?
Oui, monsieur.
Tell me, how do you say in Breton, comment se dit-il, ville, town?
Très.
Très. I thought it might be. And, how about, œil? Oeil? That, le garde?
Mais oui, le garde. Et alors, d'où savez-vous ça?
Ah. Let's try, heart. Cœur. Calon?
Calon, oui.
Go away, Hanky. You're interrupting a pan-Celtic entente. And how about... Breton, you know.
I was telling her about the close affinity between the Welsh and the Bretons.
Oh, really, sir? Yes. How interesting.
Yes, the Celtic races must stick together, you know. They have so much in common.
Oh, yes, yes, indeed we have, sir.
Le conseil de guerre peut achever ses devoirs si vous êtes incapable de faire attention, mon égard.
I think not, Prime Minister.
Un côté d'année, nous n'avons jamais l'honneur de la patrie, la gloire de la France, et que nous, Français, doivent exiger nos demandes.
Qu'est-ce qui se passe?
Oh, monsieur, c'est monsieur Clémenceau.
Nous devons pulvériser l'Allemagne, afin qu'elle n'aurait jamais encore l'audace de la France. D'achever son cupidité, ses aspirations, d'écraser n'importe qui les...
Tell me, Hanky, how would you deal with this prima donna?
It is a problem, sir.
He's on his home ground, you see. That puts him well up for a start.
He's got a hell of a temper.
Tiger Clemenceau, the man who eats ambassadors for breakfast.
Yes, it's a great pity President Wilson won't be there to redress the balance.
It's a war council, Hanky. Wilson's not interested in war. He's waiting for peace, so that he can lead wicked old Europe back into the paths of righteousness. Why he had to take 14 pints to do it, heaven knows. Even the Lord God was satisfied with 10.
If you are going to stand up to the tiger, Prime Minister, it might be wiser not to steal quotations from him.
He said that today. I wish I had. Very good line. Do you know, I think he and I might get on quite well together. Once he realizes he's not going to get me cringing and biting my nails like everybody else. Yes, you've got to be quick in the draw with a man like that.
Do you intend shooting from the hip, then?
Yes, if necessary. Yes, the thing with a man like Clemenceau is to stand up to him at the beginning and make absolutely you don't lose the first encounter.
Yeah, but how can you make certain of that?
Well, that's the simplest thing in the world. It's no legal trick. You pick your own subject. There's got to be one, of course, that isn't absolutely vital to his interests or his vanity. There's got to be one that will command general support and isolate him. Then if you push hard enough, if he's not a complete Tupsin, he will back down.
Yeah, but if it's not vital, well, what have you gained?
Psychological advantage. It's the first meeting that sets the tone.
Look, he's got everybody cringing up to now, hasn't he? And ambassadors, prime ministers.
I've got to get in there quickly and break the pattern. All I've got to do is to get into the right mood.
Well, there's nothing on tonight. You can get in a nice long sleep, good breakfast, well, a bit of time to relax.
I don't want to relax. I want to get tense. I want to go into that conference room feeling like a tiger.
Thank you. Eh bien, monsieur, il reste pour moi l'honneur de vous accorder au nom de la République française notre chaleureux accueil. Eh bien, maintenant...
There is one issue which I must insist on having cleared up before we can proceed any further.
Comment?
When I finally managed to secure the agreement of all Allied powers to setting up the Supreme War Council, it was as an integral part of the Rapallo Agreement, drawn up in November last year, which committed your country and mine to give some active, if belated, support to our hard-pressed Italian allies. I am astonished to find that certain highly placed French spokesmen are talking about the Rapallo undertaking as having to be renegotiated because it was signed by your predecessor and not by yourself. Now, if these solemn undertakings are to be thrown into the melting pot, whenever the French encounter another domestic political crisis, they are a complete waste of everybody's time. Now, I have made arrangements to return to London this afternoon, unless you can assure me that the undertaking signed by Monsieur Painlevé will be honored in its entirety.
D'accord. Maintenant, ensuite, le premier article de l'ordre du jour.
Merci, garçon.
So far, so good, Hanky. Oh, look at those. Nothing matters, though?
Well, one problem has just cropped up, sir, about our reporting back to London. Apparently, the Germans are tapping our lines and decoding the messages.
Oh. Well, we'll have to find another code, won't we?
Yes, but it seems it takes some time to organize.
Get London and tell them to put Ernest Evans on the phone. I'll give the report myself.
But the lines are being tapped, Prime Minister.
I shall be talking Welshman. And if the Germans put their experts onto decoding that, it'll tie them up in knots for a 12-month. Don't you like snails, Hanky?
I prefer to leave them in the garden, sir.
That's all right, Marcy.
She the one in the News of the World?
Ah, there you are, Bob. Nice to see you again. I've just been reading your speech to the Federation. I hear you had a marvellous reception. Jimmy! No, I don't think we've met since the Nottingham rally, have we?
That's right, Prime Minister.
Croissant. Gwyn, sit down here. Sit down, Tiley. Young, no. With you. Make sure we're not disturbed, and could you arrange for some tea to come up? Dick Roder, come in.
You've got these young lads. They start in the quality, learning the job. And what happens? When they get to be 19, when they're just starting to get to know the ropes, you're whipping them away to France. I mean, damn, it's playing havoc with the whole mining industry. You don't realize.
I know. It's absolutely vital that you keep the skilled man. That's why I spend days discussing it with the Manpower Commission, trying to keep the figure as low as possible.
Point I'm making is, and if you hadn't got badly out of touch, there'd be no need for me to make it. is that you can push the miner so far and no further.
And if we were down tools tomorrow, boy, it would be all up.
If you were fair, you'd admit that nobody in this country has got a better record than I have for getting exemption for industrial workers.
Oh, aye. But that's when you were at the Ministry for Munitions. Oh, all we heard about then was output. How the factories were depending on coal, the Navy depending on coal.
What's the Navy doing now? Going back to sea, Larry?
It seems to me that whatever job you happen to be in, you expect the whole world to jump to it and help you make a go of it.
Right, Bob.
And if I hadn't expected it before, I expect it now. Because the job I happen to be in at the moment is winning the war. One way or another, the next few weeks are going to be decided. Bob, I'm in your hands.
Doch.
Bob, the whole country is in your hands. If you want to see us lose the war, or you want to see the war dragging on to 1921-22, we all know you've only got to lift your finger and all the lives that have been lost in the last 4 years will be thrown away, wasted. And we also know that the miners are the blood royal of the whole trade union movement. And if they agree to pull their weight for a little bit longer, then all the others will fall into line.
How do we know it's going to be for a little bit longer? The papers have been stuffing us how we've been winning the war since 1914.
Because I have finally convinced the Americans that the position is urgent and they are training troops as fast as they can. And if we can hold out for a few weeks longer, then they will be pouring troops in at the rate of 250,000 a month, Bob. Fresh troops, raring to go, 250,000 every month. Bob? Asking you to hold back for another 6 weeks.
Oh.
By then, Bob, you won't have to take my word for it. By then, the whole world will know we are winning.
You talk as if it's in our hands. We are only representatives. Our job is merely to...
I know what your job is. Your job is to squeeze every last ounce of concession out of me by pretending you're sitting on a seething cauldron of revolution. While I take win, I'm not that much out of touch. When I visited your Clydeside last year, that description wasn't far from the truth, and they held me down. But I went back this year, and they listened. There is unrest, Bob. But your men trust you. And it is not beyond your powers to hold it in check.
What it comes down to is you're asking us to go home empty-handed.
Nothing of the kind. You take me for a fool. I'm proposing that you remove this pistol from my head, and then perhaps in the next 3 hours we can hammer out a compromise.
All right, I'm with you. I'll give him a bit more rope. Once the war's over, it's the end of the coalition. Where will he be then? Out on a limb, boy. Not the biggest mistake you ever made?
You mean Arthur Henderson?
Best socialist we ever had in the cabinet. Where is he now? Out of the back benches. Nothing to do but to build up the Labour Party for the next election. When that happens, LG's in for a hell of a shock.
Oh, goodness, you've arrived.
What, Sarah?
Sarah.
Still up?
I was getting quite worried about you.
Oh, do you know it's nearly 1:30 in the morning?
1:30. My watch must have stopped. Shh.
Now, go to bed, Sarah.
What's that, Sarah?
Oliver Cromwell was a Welsh.
I thought everybody knew that. His real name was Williams.
Well, H.G. Wells heard that bit and he turned round to me and said, I suppose we shall all have to refer to Williams the Conqueror.
Wish I'd left earlier, though. I'm so tired.
So here, let me. I'll do that. Why does Max have to invite horrible people like Lady Cunard? You know, she leaned across and said really loudly, friend of mine would like to have a baronetcy. How much would it cost? Would 30,000 be enough?
What did you say?
I said I knew nothing about it, which I don't.
She's a bitch.
There.
And you look beautiful tonight. And I wasn't the only one who thought so either, because I could have strangled that idiot in a black mustache who kept mooning about after you.
His intentions were entirely honorable.
Who was he?
He was.
Who was he?
Nobody.
Well, you seem to be enjoying yourself.
Well, it's very nice to know that there are still some people who'd like to make an honest woman of me. I'm sorry, darling. It's nights like this when I find it hardest, because it only shows how it could always be. If instead of just a few people that understand and don't mind about us, it could all be above board and we could go everywhere together. I feel quite black about it sometimes. I don't think it's ever going to happen. I think she's just going to squat there in Cricketh, growing older and fatter and smugger. Except when there's a bit of limelight, she'll suddenly appear and she'll sit there, smirking in the front row, the virtuous, devoted, pious Mrs. Lloyd George. And she'll poke her nose into every corner just to make sure, you know, the coal bills are being kept down, and so she can talk Welsh in front of people that don't understand. And I always have to sneak out of the back door like a kitchen maid caught stealing the spoons. And she's going to live to be 100. And she's going to dance on my grave. I know I can feel it in my bones. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said all that. You say you don't put much of a price on your dignity. Well, it probably repels you when I lose grip of mine. But it doesn't happen often, does it?
You are my true love, the heart of my heart. Whatever you do. So you imagine that you would feel happier if you were to hear me join in saying nasty things about Maggie. But you wouldn't really, you see. Because you'd think, if he can talk like that about her behind her back, how do I know what he's saying about me when I'm not here?
I know there's nothing you can do. Not in your position. And not in the middle of the war and everything. I know it's not fair to...
Oh! How many times? Like 100 times, at least, in the last 6 months. When I've had my back to the wall and everything's going wrong and enemies stamping at my heels. Haven't I been unfair? Think of the times that I've snarled and growled. The sweetest little girl in all the world.
Yes. Why?
Because, you see, if I'd lost my temper with those who really deserve it, I might do irreparable damage.
You are a bit like that sometimes.
Oh, I know, I know. See, in this job career, the number of people you can really trust by the time you got this far has shrunk to almost nothing. And I know I can trust you. Absolutely. And if I couldn't say that to somebody, I think I'd go out of my mind.
Yes. Good.
Let's go to bed.
Yes, in a minute.
Oh.
Oh, you can wait a second, can't you? You can look at tomorrow's papers.
I really don't feel like looking at tomorrow's papers. Francis, get me copies of Hansard, April the 9th and April the 23rd.
Why? What did this happen?
God. letters and sent it to every one of them, say. April the 9th or 23rd.
Whatever it is, you can't do anything about it tonight. I'll put you back. What are you doing?
Sending a J.T. It's pretty obvious you're not willing to do even the slightest.
Oh, all right. I'll get it. I'll get dressed. Am I allowed to know what it's about or not?
They're after my blood. That's what it's about. And they're setting up Major General Sir Frederick Morris to stick the knife in.
Over what? Over what?
He's written to the newspapers, claiming that I lied to the House of Commons. A serving officer publicly accusing his own government. It's unheard of. And he wants an investigation.
You haven't lied. What's he talking about? Let them have one, you'll be clear.
That is not the point. I couldn't go through all that again. Oh, I couldn't go through all that. Those months of waiting and worrying. See, that Marconi affair just about did for me. And I wasn't then trying to defend myself with one hand and fight the war with the other.
Darling, nobody will blame you.
You don't understand my position, do you? Any previous Prime Minister in the whole history of Parliament, if he'd been subjected to an attack like this, would have known he had the political party solidly behind him. The wheels would turn, the machinery would operate, the party would be shield and defender. I haven't got that, you see, because Asquith leads the Liberal Party from the opposition benches. He's never forgiven me for taking his place as Prime Minister.
And so I suggest we implement yesterday's decision. General Morris's breach of discipline to be dealt with by the Army Council, the charges to be investigated by two judges. If we announce this to the House of Commons, I would say that there's
that
every
is
chance
that
they
going to
will
satisfy answer. Them now. Mr. Asquith has just put down a motion in favor of a select committee. Well, he's not going to get one.
I can't really see the alternative. The charges can't simply be ignored. The House will never stand for it.
And a select committee does have the virtue of meeting in camera. It wouldn't entail giving valuable information to the enemy.
It would give us a breather, Prime Minister. Mm-hmm. Time to sift all the facts and answer the charges.
Look, we all know what's behind all this. Morris is one of that faction that's always regarded Haig as a little military genius. And they've managed to hold on to this belief through disaster after disaster. The Somme, Passchendaele, Flanders, every one of them is going to be the brilliant strategic coup, the key to victory. And every one of them was a calamity.
What they're trying to imply is that you were responsible for Passchendaele, that you sabotaged the campaign by keeping troops at home when they were needed in France.
Sabotaged my foot. I'll be frank with you. I never had any faith in Haig's strategy. He was throwing away the cream of our army week after week, and it made me sick every time I thought about it. And I did grudge him every contingent that went out there. I would have liked to have kept them here until General Foch could have taken over and then made effective use of them.
But isn't that just what General Morris is accusing you of?
Oh, no, 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 that's only my personal opinion. He's accusing me of acting on it. It wasn't my decision to keep the reserve here in England.
It's true. It wasn't a cabinet decision at all. That was decided by the general staff.
Exactly, for their own convenience. As for Haig, he had all the men he asked for. He simply misjudged Ludendorff's intentions, that's all, and kept the bulk of his men in the wrong place. As usual.
Whatever your personal opinions may be, Prime Minister, you cannot publicly denounce the Commander-in-Chief as incompetent.
I don't feel it's a matter that can be simply glossed over. The atmosphere in the House at present is very anxious.
They're losing their nerve. They're losing their temper. Because for the first time they realize the possibility that we could lose the war. And they're flapping about screaming that heads must roll, preferably mine. The whole thing is being whipped up and orchestrated by the Northcliffe Press and the Cadbury Press. And exploited by certain members of the opposition benches who've been waiting months for a chance like this.
If you mean Asquith, I really don't think his intention in bringing this motion is to bring down the government.
Oh, really? What is his intention, then?
Well, I suppose he's hoping to occasion us some embarrassment.
Oh, is that all? Oh, he thinks it would be a helpful and constructive move, does he? And the outcome of the war is balanced on a knife edge. And we are asking the people for every last ounce of effort and sacrifice to try to convince the country that it's being led by a cowardly, squabbling bunch of incompetent liars, who, nevertheless, he wishes to see remain in office. Oh, no, if he really believes that slanderous load of tripe, let him have the courage of his convictions and tell us to go.
Prime Minister, as leader of the House, I have to advise you that whether before a select committee or whatever other tribunal, these charges must be faced and answered. I cannot be responsible.
All right, they want answers, they shall have answers. Tomorrow, in the House. I want this thing cleared up in 24 hours. That's all the time I can spare, and it is more than they deserve. They want a debate. By God, I'll give them a debate.
I'm afraid this is the biggest mistake he's ever made.
They'll tear him to pieces.
They can compel the attendance of witnesses, production of documents, and they can administer the oath. What is more important, they can sit in secret. Now, I suggest it is our duty to set up such a tribunal of inquiry. Capable of giving Parliament and the country a prompt, decisive, and authoritative judgment.
The Prime Minister.
This motion, Mr. Speaker, is absolutely without precedent in the entire history of this House. Never has it been suggested, even in peacetime, when there might be time to give to it, that a select committee of this House of Commons should inquire into the accuracy of statements made by ministers. What then has led up to it? A general, a distinguished general, has felt himself impelled to write to the newspapers, challenging statements made by me to this House. Now, if his motive was to bring the truth, as he conceived it, to the attention of this House and of the country, then he chose a very strange way of doing it. When I delivered that speech, General Morris was Director of Military Operations. He attended a cabinet meeting the very next day. I was in daily contact with him. In fact, I was under the impression that he was a very good friend of mine. Now, what is this argument all about? General Morris seems to have convinced himself that if the people have been led to expect victories on the Western Front, and these victories are not forthcoming, that is solely because the military leadership under Field Marshal Haig has received inadequate supplies of manpower from this government. So, the issue is a very clear one. I said the fighting strength of the army had increased in the past year. General Morris said it had decreased. I find it very strange that General Morris, of all people, should challenge these figures. Where does he imagine I got them from? When I am asked for statistics from any given department, it is not my custom to conjure them out of thin air. I got them from the official records of the War Office, from General Morris's own department. I'm now going to read from the actual document.
Is it not against the rules of the House to read part of a document without disclosing the whole of it?
If the House wishes to read this, from which I am reading, I am fully prepared to lay it on the table.
honourable friend need not be afraid. I'm not going to shirk anything. I'm going to give all the sources of information and let the public judge. Here is the statement from General Morris's own department. It will thus be seen that the combatant strength of the British Army was greater on the 1st of January 1918 than on the 1st of January 1917. This confirmation came from General Morris's own department 9 days after I first made that statement. The Right Honourable Gentleman has admitted that this action by General Morris was a flagrant breach of discipline. He has admitted it. I wish he had also deplored it. He understands perfectly well the effects of incidents like these and of the constant, deliberate and vindictive attack on the honour and integrity of those who were in charge of the conduct of the war. He knows all about the possible repercussions on the war effort. No man knows it better. Because for 2 years, he was in this position. He was himself responsible for the conduct of the war. At the end of this debate, if this motion is carried, he will again be responsible for the conduct of the war. No! Make no mistake! This is a vote of censure on the government. If this motion is carried, we could not possibly continue in office. No! France. The Germans are silently preparing perhaps the biggest blow of the war under the shroud of mist. I was asked by the military for certain help. I have brought back a list of the things they wanted done, and I wished to attend to them. I really beg and implore for our common country, whose fate is in balance now and in the next few weeks, that there should be an end to this sniping.
Affair.
Yes. Oh, yes. I'm afraid it also marks the end of the Liberal Party.
I had a nice long letter from Olwyn. Mm. She seems very happy.
She wrote to me, too. Did she send you a photo of the baby? Oh. Isn't she a sweet little thing? I wonder if they'll come to Cricket for Christmas.
back through the village. I'll buy some cigarettes.
Why cigarettes? You always smoke cigars.
The debt of honour, Maggie. About 9 months ago, I bet Lord Derby 100 cigarettes against 100 cigars.
That doesn't sound very fair.
I'm trying to tell you something. I had a wager with him that the war would drag on into 1919. He said it wouldn't. He is going to win.
Oh, Dave. Are you sure?
Austria and Hungary have signed a separate peace treaty. I don't think Germany can hold out much longer. Just a matter of days, probably.
Deal, he will. Now, you tell me who you want to come, and I'll make out a list, and I'll let them know right away.
List?
This is the news we've been waiting for. I thought you'd want to celebrate.
Celebrate? Oh. Not tonight. There's been too much slaughter, misery.
I know. But we've won, David. Nothing could change that.
No, I mean, later on, you know, there'll be parades and all that sort of thing. But just tonight, just thank God it's all over.
Just as you say.
If Uncle Lloyd were alive, he'd be on his knees now. Prayer and fasting.
I take it you're not going to go that far.
I wouldn't have time for an amen. I've got to get ready for the election.
What? Right away? Oh, surely you can take a rest first.
Oh, my dear girl. The problems of war are nothing compared to the problems of peace. Like the problems facing us now. Reconstruction. Peace treaties. Jobs for the troops coming home. Unions, Ireland. Oh, God, Ireland. 1,001 issues that people are ready to sweep out of sight for the duration, but now going to re-emerge in one solid, screaming phalanx. If I put off the election long enough to get bogged down in that morass, then I could get tipped out of office into the wilderness for 10 years.
Oh, I don't believe it.
Oh, don't you?
But how can you ever forget what you've done for England? I mean, Britain.
Easily, very quickly, overnight.
But if this situation is so difficult, they're going to need a strong man, aren't they?
Man needs a party, team, power base.
But you've got a wonderful team. You've got some of the best brains in the whole country.
There's too many Tories, though. Oh, they were loyal enough in the time of war. How long is that going to last, though? What's the date?
November the 11th.
November the 11th. Tomorrow, take a note.
Tomorrow,
call a meeting of the leading Liberals, all of them, before Asquith gets hold of them. And you can draft a policy statement.
Shush. Listen, come and see me.
Ah, come on, no. And then, when we've done all that, I think I'll go home for a day or two.
Home? cricket, I suppose. I didn't realize you still saw it in that way. I thought that after all we'd been through together here, that somehow you saw this as being out.
My dear girl. Number 10, home. It's the commonest delusion in politics.
Where are they now? Your wife and Megan?
Taking them down to Walton Heath.
Oh. I might have known she'd come to London. Now it's all over. Time to be in at the kill. To share in the victory parades and the banquets. And bouquets.
And all you can share in is my work. All my thoughts. All my hopes and dismays. My mind and my heart. My days and my nights. Would you really change places with her?
The series continues on Tuesday night at the same time here on BBC 2W.